Hello, everybody. People in Greece, it's quite late, so thank you for being here. People in the US, it's earlier, but still thank you for being here. Before I begin, allow me first to extend my gratitude to the Center of Hellenic for Hellenic Studies and its senior fellows and board that offered me the opportunity to pursue my research within, albeit from far away, the environment of the center. Special thanks also to Lana, who is not here, and the personnel at the library, at the CHS library in DC, that have been really helpful all through this difficult period. And as always, when talking about my research at the site of Messene, I need to thank publicly again the director of Messene excavations, Professor Petros Temelis, who have entrusted me with researching the material, the fabulous material, some of it you will see tonight. Beyond the director, there is a large number of people working at the Messene project, team members, personnel, who in one way or another have made possible much of what we will see. Tonight, I'm going to talk to you about a society, not so much unlike ours today, a society on the verge of breakthroughs and collapse at the same time, that of the mid-4th century in the Roman provincial setting of South Greece. I will try to talk based on material coming from our excavation at Messene on some of these changes that the late Roman or early Byzantine society was going through, with a highlight on the social and ideological processes themselves as they leave their mark on the material output of a society and on the limited traceable evidence that archaeology can collect and meaningfully reconstruct. This I intend to do through two parallel narratives originating from the same limited space of the city center of Messene. Narratives that are met by the same ending, the destruction and the upheaval caused by a major natural destruction phenomenon, an earthquake, and that in some ways intersect in each other. The first narrative is what I'm calling here, in failing to find a better phrasing, a pagan story. Our story starts far away from Messene and a bit later than the period we will be examining, and it takes us to the city of Constantinople, the newly established capital of the Eastern Roman Empire, what some of us prefer to still call the Byzantine Empire. There, in the mid-5th century of our common era, the historian Sozomen, in his great work, The History of the Church, wrote a short note about the way that the emperor Flavius Julianus, who reigned on the throne of the Roman Empire from 360 to 363, how this emperor managed his public image. Emperor Julian, of course, was one of the most controversial Byzantine emperors, famous for his support for the declining traditional Greek and Roman pagan religion and for his rather mildly anti-Christian stance. So we read in the text of the Sozomen. Julian caused to be painted in juxtaposition with his own figure on the public pictures, a representation either of Jupiter coming out of heaven and presenting to him the symbols of imperial power, or else of Mars or of Mercury with their eyes intently fixed upon him. He placed the picture of the gods in juxtaposition with his own in order that the people might be led to worship them under the pretext of rendering due honor to him. To this text, I am intentionally juxtapositioning myself a most suggestive virtual restoration of the described scene. I'm using here a life-sized sculpted image of an unknown Constantinian emperor to the right. And do not forget that Julian actually belongs to this dynasty, along with the remains of its pair, a life-sized statue of Hermes, Mercury, created by the same workshop at the same place and moment in time, using the same material and probably made to be exhibited together. But we will return to the mystery sculptures of ours in a moment. The story that Emperor Julian combined his image with the story that Emperor Julian combined his image with ancient statuary in order to divert the piety offered by Christian Roman citizens to the imperial image towards the images of the old gods was obviously part of a Christian polemic against Julian. It is preserved in a number of Christian authors and seems to originate very close to the actual time of the events, the time of the reign of Julian, as we read it firstly in a homily against Julian by Gregory of Nazianzus, the bishop of Constantinople, just a few years after the death of the emperor. If we turn to another text compiled much later, in the 8th century, the Parastasis Syndomes Chronikes, a text containing several narratives about Constantinople and its monuments, we read beyond the usual topos accusations another interesting account on statues of Julian and his family. According to this story, in Nicomedia, the once imperial capital of Diocletian in Bithynia, after a great destruction caused by an earthquake, Julian had two older statues, one of Apollo and another of Artemis, set up, naming them as pictures of himself and of his wife. And you see the text on the left. I'm not reading it in order to save time. Again, I'm juxtaposing to this story the 4th century imperial image that we just saw. You see the emperor on the left, but this time next to an earlier statue, a 2nd century Roman copy of a Hellenistic original depicting the goddess Artemis in the type of Lafria, maybe close to what Julian used to portray his wife. The stories that we just read contain much more than Christian polemic against Julian. They contain actual observable strategies of visual politics employed by the emperors of the Constantinian dynasty in the mid-4th century. Visual strategies of appropriating the past and projecting power in the present that were understood as such by both the people responsible for the creation of the imperial image and of course by their contemporaneous viewers. In many ways, these issues are being hot topics in the literature on late antique statues, their creation, their position, and their reuse. In this way, what we as modern viewers or scholars, for example, in the synthesis I'm presenting here, see can be radically different than what the viewers of a certain time would have understood. At their time, aided by a number of external factors that we are now missing. Inscriptions, garments, special setting, colors, etc. What we largely lack is the hands-on understanding of how these arrangements were phrased in the cities and buildings of the 4th century and in what relationship they would have been with other players in the late Roman urban scape, like the triumphing Christianity. And after this long introduction, let's land ourselves to the Messenian universe. I will not tire you with details about the history and the monuments of Messene. The city was a major urban settlement of the Hellenistic and Roman Peloponnese and the local center or metropolis of Messenia in the southwest Peloponnese that you see up left. It was an inland settlement heavily invested on its past as the focal point for the construction of the local national Messenian identity after the breakaway of the region from the Spartans in the early 4th century BCE. Messene adapted quickly to the Roman realities and became a close ally to the Romans, a process that led in different ways to its resurgence in the imperial period as a city full of ancient monuments, actually renovated ancient monuments, with wealthy and influential local elites and ties to Italy proper. This is the city museum, the city's last museum that was glorified by the detailed description of Pausanias in the 2nd century of our common era. As with most of the settlements of Achaia, besides Corinth, of course, the third and fourth century for Messene becomes a period extremely difficult to follow historical evolution at a local level. On the PowerPoint, you can see the location of Messene, the plan of the city with its fine hippodamian grid system, and the city center that has been the focus of excavation for the recent decades. In this city center that you see a bit tilted in the screen in order to get as much detail on, was designed already in the initial late classical and early Hellenistic urban grid of the city, reserved for public buildings, sanctuaries, and other monumental function. We can discern excavated monuments like the theater in the north, that would be far to the right, the agora, the large temenos of Asclepius, the gymnasium and stadium complex. Very little evidence for domestic use of this space survives from Hellenistic times, when most of the insulae dedicated for domestic units must have been in the unexcavated space between the city center and the fortified wall of the city. Greatest interest in living near or in the very center of the city is evident from Roman imperial period onwards, a process that comes to a high point in the late Roman period during the third and fourth century. To this period date, the latest surviving phases of modifications found in three exceptionally large and lavishly decorated urban houses, domi, Latin, Roman domi. These houses, their excavation and material culture have been the focus of my research so far on fourth century in Messene. And tonight I will be talking to you on material from Domus I near the theater and Domus II, the red one near the temenos of Asclepius. In the second half of the fourth century comes a rather sudden end to the ancient way of living in the city of Messene. Life continues, albeit with a small 10 or 20 year break into the early Byzantine city of Messene, but nothing ever is the same. The old monuments lie in ruin, the city grid is completely disregarded, and more that fall outside our discussion tonight. So let's revisit our statues, the ones that we already saw in regards to Julian's imperial strategy. They are imperial imagery. They are actually three smaller than life sized statues discovered in the systematic excavation of the of Domus II, of the late Roman phases of Domus II of Messene. It is a depiction of Artemis on the right in the type of Lafria, a work of the Antonine period, measuring approximately 140 meters, 1.40 meters. Next to it, two fourth century original works were recovered. In the middle, a statue of an emperor depicted in a hunting attire, saluting with his right raised hand and holding an orb on his left, measuring almost the same, and a partially surviving nude statue of Hermes that would have been of the same scale with imperial image. In the general relativity of our interpretations of archaeological material, the striking part in this slide is the effort to exactly date the proposed, the final arrangement of these statues. This effort actually reflects the archaeological context that the Messene sculptures were found in, an horizon of destruction and abandonment that has been positively identified as a result of the 365 great earthquake of the Eastern Mediterranean. The earthquake of 365 is one of the best documented major seismical events of antiquity, and the literature is on it is huge. Its epicenter has been pinpointed somewhere near the coast of Western Crete, and its catastrophic effects on the settlements, mainly of Crete, has been subject of a large number of archaeoseismological studies. The southwest Peloponnese, although it is regarded as one of the worst hit areas in the models by seismologists, like the one you see in the middle, and also is attested in the famous text by Ammianus Marcellinus on the right, discussing the major tsunami and closing with the effects it had on the settlement of Methone, and that's the part in yellow. Very little archaeological work has been done until very recently. Messene is the main settlement that offers and publishes evidence for the effects of the 365 earthquake. And lately, also a much smaller excavation at Gerolimenas in Mani had provided us with some further and very, very interesting evidence. In Messene, the three statues discussed were found in such a destruction context inside the main hall of Domus II and fallen in front of the far back wall where probably they stood in niches opening in the thickness of the wall. The statue of the emperor and Hermes were collected by Orlandos in the old excavations of the site as they were dug out by farmers at the same spot. Excavation initiated in 1990 revealed the statue of Artemis. You see it in pieces, and smaller fragments of the imperial portrait and Hermes that had not been originally found by Orlandos. The entire main hall of Domus II exhibited the picture of a sudden destruction that happened around 360-370, never to be rebuilt or reused, with only later events of stone robbing and removing of other precious materials like the marble opus sectile pieces or the large fine limestone slabs of the floor. Extensive parts of masonry from the walls or from dividing arches were found collapsed in situ where they were fallen inside the main hall in a layer full of coins, the latest of which dates to the rulership of Constantius II, ending in 361. The central hall of the Domus totally dominates the entire building, with its dimensions, arrangement, and luxurious decoration, especially since these exact attributes make this room in a much better state of preservation than any of the other ones. The hall forms an elongated orthogonal and measures in total approximately 22 by 10 meters. It is oriented north to south and has access through a monumental colonnaded opening on its narrow south side that would lead to an open central court. The hall is divided into two spaces, a smaller south anteroom and a large main hall in the north. The anteroom floor was covered by mosaics. Entrance to the main room was through three openings in the dividing wall and a major central monumental arched opening, parts of it we found collapsed, secured the actual access to the main room. The main room was lavishly decorated with floors paved with newly cut large limestone slabs and an exquisite opus sectile of marble and lapis laconicus, red local marble. The pavement created a T or a U, an inverted T or a U-shaped pattern that is often favored in late Roman halls that would host symposia, although in Messene there were not found any built constructions of any kind, like Stibadia. The walls of the main hall were also lined with marble revetments, as it can be seen in many of the still surviving walls. You can see it at the far end of the picture to the left. Although most of the characteristics of the large hall of the Domus near the terminus of Asclepius can be traced in many other examples in the Peloponnese, Achaia, and Greece in general. The sheer size of this hall and its monumentality takes it apart of any other known example. Actually, closer examples in the form and dating are better found across the sea in the Italian peninsula. Villa Faragola, a late antique complex near Foggia, with its final face in the 5th century, has a central hall, a kenatio, as it is called in Roman archaeology, Italian Roman archaeology, with a prominent place for the Dominus at the far side on a built stibadium, as we can see. Very similar to the size and position that the hall in Messene has. But what accentuates the architecture of the Messenian Domus main hall is the sculptural find discovered in the north of the hall at its far side. We can imagine the archon of this domus being seated or presented exactly in front of these three statues, with them investing him with their imperial and divine authority. The three statues are of different dating, and they were unified in a composition in a secondary or even tertiary use at some point in the 4th century before the destruction of 365. At the time of the excavation of the hall, it had been suggested that this synthesis, what we see, was comprised of two newly made in the 4th century, meaning newly made in the 4th century statues, that of the emperor and of Hermes, and an older one, that of Artemis, that was collected from some old monument of Messene. A newly discovered inscribed statue base found in Messene and built as material in the walls of a 6th century Christian basilica near the theater had offered crucial new insight of the processes regarding the setting, reusing, and recycling of sculptural monuments in 4th century Messene. The base was originally the crowning of a Hellenistic or Roman statue pedestal. It was then recycled in Constantinian times when a marble statue was set on top of it and an inscription mentioning a member of the family with the name Constantinos, not very clear which one of them, was cut by the city of the Messenians. That would be the inscription you see on top left. But this was not the last episode of the stone's recycling story. At some point, the marble Constantinian statue was removed and a new bronze imperial portrait was set on top with a new inscription, cut again by the city, but on the opposite side of the same stone, this time honoring Valentinian I. That would be the inscription you see at the lower right. The dimensions of the base and the marks and the markings on the upper surface that correspond to the side of the Constantinian inscription fit great with the existing Constantinian statue from the Domus that we've already seen. In this way, the Constantinian statue finds also an earlier use than its placement inside the Domus, much like the Artemis statue. And by its close affinity to the statue of Hermes, we said that they are from the same material and probably they were made together, we can securely hypothesize that they had been standing somewhere close together in an earlier phase, in an arrangement that actually could have resembled the way that Julian was accused of setting his own images. And we have no reason to believe that the ways of exhibiting imperial power close to deities, old or new, was not something done exclusively by Julian, although he was the only one accused for such doings. Further than that, it could be said that the communities setting these images and making could make choices like that rather than the person portrayed each and every time. This also makes even more interesting the act of collecting the old, some of them not very old, statues by the owner of the domus in order to exhibit them anew in a different and more private setting. Let's reflect a bit more on this idea of relocation inside the city. In Messene, we can observe that the setting of imperial images in Roman times followed strategies tied to handling the past and present of the community and negotiating local and state memory. Imperial portraiture was set in clusters during different times. Augustus was honored in the purposely built Sebastion near the Temenos of Asclepios, so that would be the blue case. The Flavians in the north, the Flavians were honored in the north stoa of the Agora. The Antonines in front of the temple of Messana, the city goddess. Trajan, Hadrian, and Lucius Verus in the reconstructed theater. This raises the question of how the Constantinian dynasty or their local agents related to such a past, if so. The base, the inscribed base, was found in the Basilica of the Theater. That would be that brown dot in the middle. The base was found in the Basilica of the Theater, and its separated statue was found in the Domus. Given the occasional allusions to Constantine as an heir directly of Augustus himself, one could propose that maybe honor to the first of the Constantine dynasty and subsequently the whole dynasty could have been associated in Messene with a location known for its relation with Augustus. This could actually fit very well with the creation in the early 4th century of a new colonnaded street just in front of the Sebastion of Messene. That would be, it's not very visible, Sebastian is here in the blue box. That would be the colonnaded street in front of it. It's a work of the first half of the 4th century. But even if we can propose a possible position for the Constantinian statue and for Hermes, we are still in the beginning of understanding the context of the withdrawal of the statues from a public into a private setting. And this could bring me to the Christian version of the same story. This time, we are talking about the other domus, the one in red. We see on the upper left side, domus one, which is located near the theater. Again, a very interesting building with many, many phases. I will start again with citing a text outside of Messene and maybe exposing the great secret of this building. I tend to believe that this building, this Roman domus, had at some point or had at many point, different points Christian use. And so in the 3rd and 4th century can be associated with texts like this small excerpt from Eusebius' church history, when he describes that after the persecutions, halls devoted to the Christian use, they were small, they were not fitting enough, so they had to be widened up and remodeled, like in the series of modifications that we will see in the Messene Domus one. But in the core of it and underlying the late Roman phase, what we see is another, an insula created in the Hellenistic period and probably first occupied by a Roman house in the imperial times with a number of subsequent later phases. And you can see here exactly the location of the house west of the theater. and across one of the main streets. During the excavation of what was supposed to be a Roman house, a central area of the house, a central hall, was identified, and it was clear that it had been created from the modification of pre-existing units and rooms into a greater hall. All of it defined again by a destruction in the late 4th century connected with the earthquake. But what was made clear soon enough was that this unified main hall actually, as you can see very well in the picture, had underlying elements of different periods and a much more complex story. The systematic excavation, and I will not go into more details, but you can see this by this great, very large hall, bipartite with two parts, one to the south, which is elevated like a platform, and then much larger on its north side with limited access between them. It was quickly made clear that underneath the mosaics of the fourth century, there was a completely different arrangement. And not only that, but that the mosaics of the fourth century, actually they were not only of the fourth century, but they were part of two different distinct episodes. You can see it even in the picture where our conservators are sitting. There is the early phase of the mosaic, and then you see the walls that had been removed. And the hall has been widened with the addition of new mosaics that they are trying, not very successfully, to imitate the pre-existing mosaics. But how can we understand in chronological, the chronological correlation between these constructions? It is quite clear that the earliest Roman, there existed an earlier Roman phase of this domus, occupying most of the insula that we can see, and based on coins not very well cleaned, dating to the late second century, a new we can discern the first remodeling of the main rooms of the domus into a unified central hall that should be an event that should be dated at some point in the second century AD or CE. I would suggest that it would be in the second half of the second century, but we don't have any solid evidence. And at some later point, the initial hall made was deemed unsatisfying or not large enough. So an event that is defined again by very well dated coins set inside the mosaic, the expansion mosaic. These are Tetrarchy coins, so around 300 more or less, a coin of Diocletian and a coin of Maximianus. Another event of laying mosaics, expansive mosaics, that they are actually, this is the moment that they are taking down the walls and making a larger room. And coming to the end of use in this hall at some point after the 360s with dozens of coin finds, two large hoards that point us directly to the 365 event. Further than the detailed chronology, we were lucky enough to actually have found two texts, two donor inscriptions set in the mosaic floors of this main hall. Each of these two texts referring to the two different phases of the mosaics laid on the in the room. as they are inserted in the respective surfaces. The one on the left in the original mosaic and the one on the right on the expansion mosaic. Starting from the end, in the first half of the fourth century, in the mosaic expansion, we have the name of a person called Theodulos and carrying the title of Episcopos that we should identify as an ecclesiastical leader of the Christian community of Messene at some point before 365 and probably after 30 that we accept that Christianity would be acceptable. The mention of a bishop that we never knew before, the earliest bishop we know of Messene would be from the 5th century. But much more challenging is the identification of the donor of the original 3rd century mosaic. Here, an individual by the name of Paramonos is attested, carrying the title of Anagnostis, the reader. Such is the disambiguation that the inscription was originally identified by the excavator as referring to a pagan individual, Paramonos, who was actually a professional reader or a slave trained to read. But thorough new analysis of the epigraphic monuments of the period, and above all, the hindsight offered by the 4th century bishop inscription, points us to identify with certainty also Paramonos as a Christian anagnostis, a Christian reader, an officer of the church. Maybe even this Paramonos being the earliest leader of the Christian community, as we know from second century sources that anagnostes, readers, sometimes can be actually the title of a church leader the leader of a local church in the extremely fluid ecclesiastical organization of early Christianity. The identification of a bishop donating the mosaics in the early 4th century and a reader, anagnostis, donating the mosaics and even be the founder of the building in the 3rd century places securely in a Christian context. This is further augmented by the architecture of this early assembly hall. You see it on the right. Closely related to the very few known third century examples of Christian assembly halls, Christian meeting halls, churches, domus ecclesia, various names have been given, all of them coming originating from domestic architecture, and you see it in the third century house in Syria, in Dureuropos, and the newly excavated one in Palestine. But even the modification of the hall in the 4th century seems to follow what is happening elsewhere in the early 4th century Christian churches, basilicas, like the very closely related example of Basilica of Paul in Philippi, or the much larger but similar in plan Basilica of Theodoriana in Aquileia. And besides the building itself, even this very, very short inscription, donor inscription, seem to be an interacting between themselves in defining time, in defining donors in the building. We can see that the first original donor inscription referring to Paramonos, Anagnostis Paramonos, it's using, as it is commonly used, the verb epiise, referring as the person who made, who provided to be made. And then in the early mid-4th century, when Theodulos, the Episcopos, makes his own inscription, he uses the same verb, repeating the exact phrasing, but in a very, very rare way only a couple of other donor inscriptions exist out of thousands. He is using the verb in the present tense as PE, obviously, I believe, to differentiate himself doing something in the present to what his predecessor did some decades or a century ago. So, to come to a conclusion, these parallel movements of almost counteracting parallel movements and processes show us a very interesting way of things happening in Messene in the fourth century. We can observe at the same time from private, as in the house of the Domus Ecclesiae, in the Christian hall, of the private house that becomes gradually a communal building, becomes a church, at the same time the communal or public, as we've seen in the picture of the emperor and the deities, is removed to a closed and private space. We can actually trace this process of replacement in the public sphere between the two religious systems, between the two theories, and at the same time we see how gradually we have a withdrawal by certain players. I am closing with these short remarks, as these are more ideas that I'm exploring as part of my research. Here, some of the things I presented have been published, other have been submitted, more is being prepared. And at the end of the day, the aim is somehow to combine this material that might look different, but actually they're not so, in a coherent narrative that offers a platform of understanding the processes happening in the first half of the fourth century in the provincial setting of the Roman Empire that Messene offers.